Last time I talked about the word bank, and now it's we have to wrap it up because BIS is a small entity compared to other ones, but it's an ancient one, so it was never not made in the or during the Bretton Woods conference. Actually, it was planned way earlier when the Young and Dawes plans were negotiated to consolidate German payments after the Second or the First World War, and actually it was established in 1930 to supervise the repayment of the bonds what have to be repaid by Germany, and also to become the Bank of Central Banks. And actually, since then, they are operating on this field, that they are providing services for central banks. For example, on the field of, you can keep your gold reserves at the BIS, you can put deposits on your account at the BIS, or you can take up short-term loan from the BIS. Also, they can support you during swap agreements, swap lines can be arranged. Also, they have many different committees to do actual support and job in creating new regulations. So, we are always mentioning the Basel. Now it's 4 regulation. For the banking system, actually, it's also supervised by the BIS. So the BIS is mostly the most not so well-known, completely unknown, international financial organization. But it's funny because they are profitable. So we can see that this is made from an earlier era than the IMF or the World Bank. And it means that it's publicly listed, so you can purchase their shares on the Paris and some other. So they are listed on 2 stock markets. You can purchase it as a private citizen as well, but you don't have voting power. So voting is limited only for central banks. And it's for profit, and actually they were for profit during most of their operations. So I think that maybe 1 year during the Second World War they were not profitable, otherwise they were. You can ask my question that, and before the BIS, what happened with central banks? Actually, if you are reading economic history, we can see that most of the central banks before the First World War kept their or part of their gold reserves at the Bank of England. And at that time it seemed to be a great idea, just during the First World War, some of these gold reserves were confiscated, because if you are in the other party during a global war, then yeah, you can't have your reserves. And to solve this issue, the BIS was established in Basel, so in Switzerland. And Switzerland is excellent in many things, but banking is maybe on the top of this list. And it's also completely neutral, so it means that if there is another war, then still you can have your reserves. And it actually worked excellent during the Second World War. And it's also safer, because if you are not keeping it at home, then if you are losing in a war and this gold can be taken away, maybe you can get it back. Just for example, in Hungary, it was taking until the 70s until we get back our gold reserves. So and this was also not so much. And only partially, so we can say that it's nice to have an institution on neutral ground. And so you can see that during banking activities, the customers of the BIS are central banks and international organizations, and They have their own analysis and statistics for monetary and financial stability issues. Actually, if you are writing your thesis on the topic of international banking or related to banking anyhow, then you should check the statistical database of the BIS, because there are really good cross-border lending or borrowing data. So, if you are looking on the structure, we can see that there are many committees. I don't want to talk about most of them, but still we can see that the Basel Committee on Banking Supervision is absolutely crucial. So all the microprudential regulations, what is valid today, they are defining it with close contact with other agencies. So mostly if people are working in central banks or in financial supervision authorities, sooner or later, or usually, they can have the chance to work for some period at the BIS and then go back. So they are usually have this system when they can have the exchange workers and providing grants. Also, on Committee on Global Financial System, actually it's really nice to have it here, but practically I never heard about it. What are they doing? Maybe I was reading their papers, but they are highly... So while we can find Basel Committee everywhere, all the other committees are completely non-transparent or not fancy. Let's say not fancy, because maybe they are there just... So, products and services. To assist central banks, monetary authorities and international financial institutions in the management of their foreign exchange and gold reserves. So, yeah. Okay, today it seems to be strange that foreign exchange reserves, come on, you are purchasing government bonds electronically or digitally, and you are keeping it there. But in the past, it was important to keep the paper version of the government bonds somewhere. So it was the hard copy. Yeah. Now it seems to be strange. Yeah, we have to go keep the gold somewhere, so it's still physical. Foreign exchange reserve is... I think that still there are countries or there are opportunities when they are keeping hard copy of bonds, because why not? Just the logistics can be enormous in this case. Other bumblebee. They don't like me. They can feel the finance. Okay, so money market instruments. They are these deposits, fixed and floating rate, in most convertible currencies, so they are supporting you. And so you don't have to just to deal with SDR. Yes, we can find that fixed term deposits can be also denominated in index linked or basket of currencies like SDR, but it's not like, so they don't have any preferences for currencies, and it's really good. So that's why I mentioned that support. So until it's convertible and it's not restricted currency, then you can deal with them. Standard and non-standard amounts and maturities. Thank you guys. So you can accept money. Tradable instruments. So it means that they are issuing some bond-ish, bond-like instruments. And in this case, they are available in two forms: fixed rate investment and for any maturities between 1 week and 1 year, and medium-term investment instruments for quarterly maturities, 1 year to 10 years. So it's again, it's a friendly compared to the ESM or to the World Bank. They are medium run investors, and you can purchase it. So it's also really good, because if you need safe assets, then you are not forced to purchase only US or German government bonds, because there is the BIS. Foreign exchange and gold services. What is really nice here that we have the swap opportunity. So swap. And also some forward and option, but swap. Actually, they were also part of the big US dollar swap agreement in 2007, so that's why I'm so enthusiastic with this thing. And also, they have operations in London and in New York, so not just in Bern. Oh, Bern is so good. I like that city so much. Purchases and sales of gold, spot, outright, and swap or options. Asset management services. So if you have some reserves, you can ask them to have the investment, so you don't want to sit there and micromanage everything. Then you can say that if you can do your job with government bonds or in high grade credit securities. Obviously, in this case, you have to pay some money for that, because this is how the market works, but still, it's nice. Other services, short-term advances for to central banks, usually on collateral basis, trusted for a number of international government loans, and collateral agent functions. And, ladies and gentlemen, that's all about the international financial organizations. I hope you enjoyed this topic, because we talked about crisis management and what are the crisis situations and all the other stuff, and what is the portfolio in institutional portfolio to deal with all these issues, and how can you manage it. And we can say that they are not working sometimes well, or they are doing mistakes, but the core philosophy is here that if there is a crisis, it means that some million people messed up many things, for not for 1 year, but for maybe a decade or more. So there were ordinary citizens, politicians, and all the people, so all the entire economic and political elite messed up their things. Institutions were not strong enough or not working with high efficiency. They are not able to identify the problems, or they are able to identify the problems, just they are not able to manage it. And once the crisis happens, you can't ask an international organization to solve this issue for you. They are not Superman. They are just there, they have their intelligence, so they can understand, they can write report, they have data, they can collect data, they can correct the classified data at some levels. So they can provide you loans, they can give you advices, or maybe they can have these hard requirements during their loan contract, but still, they can just manage the situation. So still, we are talking about some million people and maybe 1,000 or more on the two sides. So the best example, the Ukraine's case, when all the high or heavy cavalry went in, so the European Union, the IMF, all the three-digit or three-letter agencies went there to solve it, but still many years later we can see that no, it's still the issue of Ukrainian people to deal with their own economy and country. So it's, you can't say that we will come there and solve it. And sometimes there is also this misbelief from private citizens or from journalists or from even from politicians that you should help us and everything will be perfect. No, you should help yourself. So that would be my closing.